Praise the Lord. Come on, let's all stand to our feet, everybody. Come on, clap your hands. Come on, give the Lord a big praise tonight. Come on, clap your hands and give Jesus a big praise. We want to welcome everybody to our Wednesday night firepower and prayer service. All those that are watching on our VFAM, we're so blessed that you tuned in. And how many are ready to praise and worship the Lord tonight? Come on, let's praise him, everybody.
Hallelujah. Let's give God praise tonight. We praise you, Jesus. Yay. Hallelujah. How many know there's no one like our God? There's nobody like him. Father, we praise you tonight. Oh, we've come to bless your name. Help us sing. Just the church, you sing it out one more time. And great are you, Lord. You sing it, you give life. You give life.
You are love. You bring
so great. Think you guys need to just tell him how great he is. He's been too good. He's been too good to deny his presence in this place. You're so great. You're so great. You're so great, God. You're mighty. You're glorious. His unfailing love is so great. This is so great. His miracles are so great. So great are you, Lord. Just tell him how great he is. He's so good. He's so faithful. Oh, great God. What a great and mighty God we serve in this place. Great are you, Lord.
Everybody sing it tonight. Now lift up your hands and lift up your voice and begin to worship him. Come on, from your own heart. Come on, begin to declare how great, how good, how awesome he is. Come on, with an audible voice. Come on, begin to worship him. Begin to tell him how much you love him. Begin to tell him how much you need him tonight. Come on, from all over this place. In the name of Jesus, we worship you, God. We praise you, Jesus. We glorify you. We need you, God. Oh, we honor you, Jesus. We worship you. Come on, lift up your voice. Lift up your hands from all over this place. Oh, we honor you, Jesus. We worship you, God. Yes. Oh, we love you, Jesus. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. We give you all the praise. In the name of Jesus. All over this place. Oh, we worship you, God. We honor you, Jesus. We worship you, God. We bless your name. We glorify you, Jesus. We exalt you, Lord. You know, as Jesus was alive and ministering from town to town, you know, there was a lot of needs that the people had. And, you know, Jesus didn't meet every need. There was a lot of people who were sick, a lot of people who were bound, a lot of people who were struggling. But, you know, those that got Jesus' attention wasn't those who had a need. It was those who went after him through worship. They would cry out, "Son of David, have mercy on me." They would cry out, Son of Man, have mercy on me. They would fall at his feet and worship him. Because your need doesn't get God's attention. It's your faith. It's your worship. Because you're able to say that even though I'm sick, you're still my healer. Even though I may not have a lot, you're still my provider. Even though I may feel a little bit weary, you're still my source of strength. See, that's what true worshipers are. They worship him in spirit and in truth. Despite your circumstance, that does not dictate who God is in your life. He's still your healer. He's still your provider. He's still your peace, your joy, your healer. Are you hearing me tonight? So don't let your present circumstance detect your worship. You got to say, regardless of what I'm facing, regardless of what I'm going through, regardless of what's happening around, I'm still going to worship you. I'm still going to praise you. I'm still going to glorify you because you are God and God Almighty. And all of a sudden, as you begin to put your faith in God, that's when God shows up and says, because he's saying I'm a healer, because he's saying I'm a provider, because you're saying I'm your strength, that's when God moves and says, now I got to heal him. I got to provide. I got to deliver, because you're declaring who God is. So for the next few moments, come on, worship him from all over this place. Oh! Yes! Jesus, hear the worship, God. We love you. We praise you. We glorify you. Come on, go after God tonight. Come on, go after him. God, we come before you. And God, your word says that you are seeking those who worship you in spirit and in truth. And that's who we want to be tonight, God. We want to be those true worshipers, God. Despite our circumstance, despite what we're going through, we put our complete faith and trust in you. Because we know, God, that you are able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works inside of us. And we ask you tonight, in the name of Jesus, that you would move in a powerful way. We pray, God, for those that are sick in body, those that maybe are praying for a loved one, maybe a family member, God. We ask you, in the name of Jesus, that you begin to release, God, miracles right now, Father. We pray for those that are astray, that are afar off. We pray, God, that you would begin to reach them and bring them home, Lord Jesus. We ask you right now, God, to do what only you can do, God, the impossible. And we thank you, God. We're careful to give you all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. We love you, Jesus, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. And Victory Outreach shouts. And Victory Outreach shouts. Come on, begin to praise him. Praise him like you already received your miracle. Come on, praise him like it's already done. Come on, praise him like you already know that you know that you know that God is on your side. And if God be for you, who could be against you? Come on, praise him tonight. Yes! Praise the Lord. Come on, somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout thank you, Jesus. Woo! Well, it's great to be here tonight. How many love to be in the presence and in the house of the Lord? And we're so excited that you're here tonight. We want to welcome everybody here, our VFAM as well. And if you're here for the very first time, we just want to greet you and let you know that you're our special guest. And if that's you, just lift up your hand just so that we can greet you. If there's anybody here for the very first time, we're so blessed that you're here tonight. And we see your hand way over there. God bless you. Praise God. So what we want you to do, we want you to get out of your seat, shake a few hands, greet your brother, greet your sister in the Lord. Go out and spread some love around at this time. if it's your tithe, if it's your offering, whatever it is that you're giving tonight, let's lift it up by faith and let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray that as we sow this seed into your kingdom, we do it by faith. We trust that, God, your word is true, that everything you say in it is yes and amen. If you said it, you're going to do it. And so, God, we release it by faith, and we trust that you're going to honor it. In Jesus' mighty name, we all say amen and amen. God bless you as you come forward to give tonight in the basket. Hallelujah. As you're making your way up to give, we're going to make a few announcements. On March 2nd at 9 a.m. here inside the church, we're going to be having the business partners meeting. We're going to be gathering, and we're going to be having none other than Matt Saavedra Jr. Not Matt Saavedra Sr., but Jr. Amen. He's a whiz at what he does, and he's going to be teaching us how to turn strangers into paying clients through social media. And so I'm excited about that day. We're going to come get some information to be able to utilize it and to make sure that God uses us to build the kingdom of God. Also, next Wednesday, we're going to have the pastor from Victor Outreach Ventura, Pastor Cisco Centeno, is going to be speaking next Wednesday. Amen. He's going to be here with us on Wednesday night. And then not only that, but we want to make sure that we're a part of the end time rally. You could scan the QR code. Make sure that you register and make sure that you're a part of this event. You don't want to miss out. Don't wait till the last minute. There's going to be people coming from all over. It's going to be a powerful time with our founders. And so let's get excited about that. Make sure you register ahead of time. Again, don't wait till the last minute. And then also, we want to make sure that we mark our calendars for the Easter production. Amen. And so they wanted to make mention of this. If you want to get involved, there's various ways you can get involved. You can pray for souls. You can fast and pray. You can also invite someone to church. But there's another way you can get involved in the production. If you have acting skills, if you're you could stage design, if you're a child, if you have a kid that can act. I know this past production, we had a young man that came out of nowhere, and he wowed the crowd. Amen. And so if you have a young person that can act, bring them out. Special makeup, if you know how to do that. Costume sewing, any type of a part of the production. If you want to be behind stage, part of the camera crew, whatever the case may be, everybody is welcome, and we want to make sure that you're a part of what's going to be taking place here on Easter Sunday. Amen. And with that, we can pay attention to the screens for some video announcements. Amen.
That's what we're seeing.
Powerful 7.6 magnitude earthquake.
Israel has formally declared war.
God will raise up leaders. God will raise up pastors. God will raise up evangelists. God will raise up missionaries. God will raise up.
Ladies, get ready.
We live for the cause.
Women's Convention 2024, where women of strength, grace, and anointing gather from every corner of the globe, together under one roof.
We are called to serve the throne.
Inspired and instilled, filled with a sense of purpose, receiving our marching orders, because we are end time women.
Courage and faith will pull down every wall that stands in front of you.
We are not just attendees. We are supporters of the vision, This convention is more than just an event. Passionate about making an impact? Then join us at this convention, where we come together as a collective force of changemakers, daughters of this great vision. Be part of the movement that transcends time, because together we are unstoppable. Register today. Women's Convention 2024 awaits you.
Come on, Victory Arches, give the Lord a good hand for what's taking place all over the world. Let's all stand. Let's all stand. And I know the V groups are on fire, right? I mean, V group leaders, I know I was able to be in attendance last night, and it was so awesome. We had a rally night here, and you can just see that God is doing something so special in our church, and the V groups is a special place to be. So I know we took the growth challenge, so one of them is to get connected. So if you want to get connected, I want to encourage you strongly to get connected to a V group. There's more information there on our website. Now, if you can take hold of your Bibles and turn to Luke chapter 18, verse 35. And as you're turning there, I just want to thank God for what he is doing in my life. He's keeping power. Grateful for our pastors. How many love our pastors? We have awesome pastors, world-class leadership, our pastors, shepherds. They really love our congregation, and they're worldwide leaders, but they make it a point to continue to give themselves to us, and I'm grateful that God blessed us with the best. Also, our entire ministerial staff, Pastor Philip and the entire team, I'm grateful to be a part of this winning team, this all-star team, and we truly have awesome leadership, really do. Also, a product of the gang, God's Anointed Now Generation, young adults and students, the third wave of revival. God is doing great things in the gang. And last, certainly not least, I have a beautiful wife, Lex, right there in the second row. We're going to be married 3 years next month, and I'm grateful that God bless you with a good wife. Can the husband say amen? How many are grateful to have a good wife? I've learned that more than ever before, the importance of having somebody side by side with you, back to back. Luke chapter 18, do you have it? And the Bible reads like this. Then it happened, as he was coming near Jericho, that a certain blind man sat by the road begging. And hearing the multitude passing by, he asked what it meant. So they told him that Jesus of Nazareth was passing by. And he cried out, saying, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." Then those who went before warned him that he should be quiet. But he cried out all the more. Say, all the more. "Son of David, have mercy on me." So Jesus stood still and commanded him to be brought to him. And when he came near, he asked him, saying, "What do you want me to do for you?" He said, "Lord, that I may receive sight." Then Jesus said to him, "Receive your sight. Your faith," say, "your faith has made you well." And immediately he received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw him, gave praise to God. The title of my message here this evening is Visible Faith. Visible Faith. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you. I thank you, Lord. You're here. We sense it ever since we walked through the doors. This time of praise and worship, the generosity of our giving. And I know you're here. So I pray that you would just move me out of the way and just take control. I know that this word you gave me specifically for your people tonight. I know that without a shadow of a doubt, Lord. So I pray, Lord, that the same way it ministered to me, that it'll minister to your people here this evening. We give you all the honor, all the praise. And we all say, you may be seated. Visible faith. Now, I don't know how many people have ever had their vision impaired in their life. A reference I can look back to is a couple years ago, I found myself, I was working and I was using a hand drill without safety glasses, right? To be honest, I keep it real, I'm in the church, right? Did not take the proper precautions, no safety glasses. And a piece of wood, a wood particle, got into my eye. And that evening was a vision night. Imagine that, right? I could not see out of one eye, and the more I tried to get it out, I ended up scratching my eye, and it got pretty bad, and I ended up having to call my wife. She had to drive me around. I had to go to ER, and they actually gave me an eye patch. I had an eye patch. I looked like a pirate, right? I looked like I'm a Raiders fan, so I looked like the Raiders logo, right? It was, you know, right? Any Raider fans? Okay. All right. Simmer down. Now, like I said, I could not see out of one eye, and I was just going crazy. My mind was thinking, man, is this going to be me for the rest of my life? But thank God for doctors. Thank God for
for a good wife. My nurse took care of me, and now I'm able to see fully. But in that short period of time, I realized what it would be to not be able to have full sight. See, going back to our text, we find a blind man who Mark identifies as Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, who was begging on the side of the road. Now in Matthew 20, part of the Synoptic Gospels, it talks about two blind men being healed by Jesus, but tonight we're going to focus on Bartimaeus. You see, beggars would often be found at the city gate where people were passing in and out, like the crippled beggar at the gate of Temple of Beautiful, the beautiful gate. So he was probably calling out to those who were passing by, asking for alms, asking for money. And so since he was blind, they say that when you lose one sense, your other senses begin to operate at a higher capacity. But I'm sure it was not hard for Bartimaeus to realize that the number of people on the road crowding the city was much larger than usual. He sensed that there was a pushing and a shoving crowd. And people are trying to grab the attention of somebody. So the blind man cries out to whoever can hear him saying, "What's going on?" And the man heard the multitudes passing by and asking this question. And they told him that it was Jesus of Nazareth that was passing by. Say he was passing by. Jesus was passing by. See, a few questions I have here for us here tonight is one, how is our hearing? How is our hearing? See, blind Bartimaeus, even though he was blind, he was able to hear. He was attentive to what was taking place around him. See, there's many people, and I'm not here to offend anybody, but I'm just going to be real here tonight. There's many people that they want to be heard, but they don't want to hear. How many know somebody like that? Well, they want their opinion to be known. They broadcast it on Instagram, Facebook, whatever their social media channel or whatever, and family gatherings. They want to be heard. And they want to be heard so bad that when the other person is talking to them, instead of listening or hearing, they're already thinking about what they're going to say next. See, sometimes that's how we are with God. Where we come to God and we're crying, we're saying, "God, this, I need this, this, that, and the other, and I'm going through this." And so we're just talking, but we don't put ourselves in a position to hear God. And instead, there's many people that they're hearing impaired, that their hearing is distorted, and they don't even realize it. They don't even know it. Or there's those that they're hearing the wrong things. They're listening to the wrong voices. They're surrounding themselves with people that possibly may have good intentions, but their advice and their direction is totally off or totally contrary to the things of God. It's kind of like when, I don't know about you, but like me, like when you're, I don't know if you've ever been lost when you're driving. How many have ever been lost? Like you're lost, you have no idea where you're at, right? The navigation's not working, the GPS is not working, and I know some people know, like, right, you lost the Thomas guy, whatever the kids would be, right? You don't know what's taking place, right? And usually when you know where you're going, you're bumping your music, podcasts, you're having the time of your life, conversation with your wife, whatever the case, you're having an awesome time because you know where you're going. But when you don't know where you're going, most people, if you're like me, when you're looking around, you're like, "This looks kind of familiar," right? You try to, you know, you go trying to check the wind, where's the wind going, the stars, or you have no idea where you're at, right? What most people do is that they silence the radio. You should do that, right? You should. I don't know what that does, but we silence the radio and we think it's going to help us, right? But it's because you want to be attentive to your surroundings. See, unfortunately, there's many people in many churches all over the world and all over the United States that they're going the wrong direction, or they have no idea where they're going, and they're not silencing the noise in their life. They're driving, and they have no direction, no sense of direction, no sense of purpose, but they still are blasting the music. They're still bumping the music. We need to come to a point in our lives where we say, "God, if I don't know what to do, give me ears to hear." Come on, am I talking to anybody here tonight? We got to get direction. We got to allow God to speak into our lives. We got to position ourselves accordingly to hear God's voice, like in Matthew chapter 11, verse 15, that he who has ears, let them hear. See, we need to clean those ears. Not physically. I mean, there may be some people that need to clean their ears here tonight, right? Do the Q-tip, like Hitch, right? Throw it away, right? Some of you may need to do that here, right? You need to clean your ears. But I'm talking about some of you need to spiritually clean your ears. You've been listening, you've been hearing the wrong things, and it's time to get back in alignment with what God has for you. Position yourself accordingly so that God can lead your life, so you can hear his voice. See, Bartimaeus now knows, because he heard, that it's Jesus that's passing by. Second question I have for us here tonight is, how loud is our shout? That's a great place to shout. How loud is our shout here tonight? See, going back to our passage, and he cried out, saying, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And those that went before him, they warned him, and they said, you should be quiet. See, the crowd, they try to silence him. You see, Bartimaeus' words show that his faith in Jesus is that he is the Messiah. You see, Jews believe that the Messiah would be a descendant of King David. And there's Jewish people that believed at that time that illness or disability was a punishment from God. And because the person had committed sins, that Bartimaeus, being a blind beggar, was told to be quiet, because in their opinion, they could have felt that he did not deserve to allow Jesus to listen to him. But even when the crowd tried to silence him, he cried out all the more, saying, Son of David, have mercy on me. See, unfortunately, there's too many people that they stop after the first shout. They shout one time, and if they don't get the response that they want, they lose their shout. They lose their praise. They lose their expectation. They lose their anticipation. See, if we're desperate to see miracles take place, if we're desperate to see change take place in our lives, we need to come to that place to shout again. Somebody shout right there where you're at. Shout like something's gonna change. Shout like miracles are most. Shout like you know that Jesus is in the room. Shout like you know that Jesus is in the house. I'm here to declare to you tonight that Jesus of Nazareth is passing by, and we need to shout, saying, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Is the church in the house here tonight? We got to get that shout back. See, unfortunately, there's too many people that they get too dignified that they forgot what it is to shout. But when they were in the world, when they really wanted something, they weren't going to let anything stop them from getting what they wanted. So how much more when we know the truth and we know that Jesus saved us and changed us and redeemed us, how much more when we know that we serve a miracle-working God that is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore? So we got to continue to shout and know that Jesus is able to do it. You got to get that shout back. Come on, shout, shout again, come on. This is not a normal Wednesday night. God is going to do something special. I feel it and I sense it. See, don't let the world silence you. See, there's many people in the world that they're loud for what they believe. Many crazy, outrageous, alternative things. I don't even have all the time to describe all these crazy, wild out things that people are loud about, take stances for. But how much more the believer? How much more the one that knows the truth that will set people free? How much more the ministry of Victory Outreach that has been reaching treasures out of darkness, hidden riches, secret places since 1967? If there is any church and if there is any ministry that has a reason to shout, knowing that we serve a miracle-working God, it should be Victory Outreach. See, unfortunately, and I'm not here to call you out, but I want to help somebody here tonight, that there may be some people that you're part of the crowd and you don't even know it. You may be on the wrong side of the story here tonight. How do you know if you're part of the crowd? You know you're part of the crowd when you get upset when they ask you to jump. Don't look at me like that. When they say smile, when they say praise, some of those are part of the crowd. He got mad when I asked you to shout right now. You're part of the crowd if you get irked when you see young people praising the Lord. You're part of the crowd if you get irked a little bit when you see the Victory Home on fire. Why is that? Because then people will start saying stuff. Oh, no, that's just a phase, brother. That's just a phase, sister. No. You're okay. You're a new believer. It's okay. That's just hype. It'll wear off one day. It's okay, brother. It's okay. Keep praising. Keep shouting. No. There's some people here tonight that you're part of the crowd. And you need to get in the right track, and you need to get your shout back and say, you know what, I don't want to be that way anymore. I don't want to be negative anymore. I don't want to be pessimistic anymore. I don't want to be a complainer anymore. I don't want to murmur anymore. I don't want to be a part of the problem. I want to be part of the solution. Look at the way that we're going to win the world and reach this city and take nations and raise up arrows is we need collectively as a multi-generational church to praise God together, to worship together, to hit the streets together, to tell somebody that Jesus is in the house. Get that shout back. Shake those cobwebs out. Some of you, you need to get pumped back to the altar again. You got to learn what it is to praise and bust a few little moves. You got to learn what it is to sweat in church again. Don't get so sophisticated and dignified and look so good in your suit and United We campaign. But you don't know what it is to break it down for Jesus. There's some people that you've gotten too cool. You've gotten so concerned what other people are going to think rather than what he thinks. I love the people around me. I love the people I serve with. I love them, but they weren't the one that saved me. They weren't the one that changed me. They weren't the one that went into my city and reached my parents and let them know that there was a church. There was a church called Victory. They weren't the one. So it was God that saved my family. So he's the one. It's an audience of one. I care about what he thinks. I don't care how I look. I don't care about title. I don't care about position. As long as I know that I am tired praising and worshiping the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, as long as my worship, as long as my shout gets his attention, that's all that matters. Don't follow the crowd. Follow the caller. Make that decision here tonight to say, Jesus, I am going to follow you, and I don't care who knows it. I don't care how I look. Because it's all about you. It's always been about you. Come on, it's the church getting their shout back, getting their praise back. Shake those cobwebs off. It is time. It is time, Victory Outreach. Come on, say it again. Jesus is in the house. It's not just a season. You can stay on fire. You can have that blue fire. You can be bold. You can live all out for God. Going back, now we're in verse 40. It says, so Jesus stood and commanded him to be brought to him. Third question I have for us here tonight is, what's going to be our response when Jesus calls us? See, it's one thing to shout, and we love to shout, but it's another thing to respond. It's good to shout. It's good to praise. It's good to be excited and energetic, but it's a whole other thing to respond to the call. The call of God is going forth here tonight. There's some people here that the call has been dormant in your life where God has called you and he wants to use you. And for whatever reason, circumstances, situations, disappointments got in the way. And now on the outward, you look like you're responding, but inwardly in your heart, you're not responding. I know there's some people here in the building that at one point you were willing to go wherever. You were willing to get a one-way ticket. And say, God, whatever you want me to go, whatever you want me to do, I'm willing. What happened? What happened? Jesus is calling us here tonight. He's commanding and he's saying, bring them to me. But will you come? Will you come with us? Will you enlist into the army of God? Will you truly take the growth challenge with us to grow, to develop, and see great things take place in our lives and in this ministry? See, there's people tonight, you're being called out from the crowd. But a response is action. God is looking for people here tonight that will be people of action, that will answer the call, that will be ready when your name is called. See, if you know you're called and you know Jesus called you, then start preparing yourself now. Unfortunately, there's too many people that they wait for their name to be called to start getting ready. But if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready. What does that mean? If you're called to take a city, if you're called to be a pastor, start pastoring in your V group now. If you're called to be an arrow, you're called to be one of Sonny Jr.'s guys, do it now. Do it now in the gang. Do it now in the gyms. Do it now in the media. Do it now in the worship. Don't wait to be asked to do it on the platform to start getting ready. But say, I'm going to get ready. I'm going to get, even when no one else sees, I'm going to get ready. I'm going to prepare myself. I'm going to equip myself. I'm going to enroll in VOBC. I'm going to learn what it is to reach people. I'm going to learn what it is to be a good communicator of the gospel. I'm going to do it now. So when my name is called, I'm going to be ready to respond to the master's voice. We got to respond. Somebody say respond. Say respond. We got to be ready. Because Jesus is looking for people to call out here tonight. And we're going to do an altar call at the end of tonight. But the question is, will you respond? Will you respond to the master's voice? Because when we respond, when we step out, he steps in. And when he steps in, great things take place. Will be great for him. Fourth question I have for us here tonight is, are we faithful? Not faithful, I mean faithful, meaning are we full of faith? Do we truly believe that God is more than able? No. Do we truly believe that God is more than able? It's not just a song we sing, but we say, God, I know you're more than able. See, in verse 41, it says, so Jesus stood still and commanded him to be brought to him. And when he had come near, he asked him, saying, what do you want me to do for you? See, Jesus, like Pastor Philip mentioned as he opened up, is Jesus already knew what this man needed. But I believe Jesus asked this question to ignite faith, not just in him, but in the crowd, and for it to be vocalized. See, his faith is now known to the entire crowd, and now it is visible faith. And it was also a declaration that he was ready to change. He was ready for change. He didn't want to be a beggar anymore. He didn't want to be begging for alms anymore, and he wanted to see. See, there's people, and I've said it many times, there's people that they want their circumstances to change, but they don't want to change. They want change to take place in their life, but they don't want God to change them. But when we come to that place of humility and submission to God and saying, God, before my situations change, change me. Change me, so when you do change my situation, I'm going to be ready for it. We got to be ready to change. See, what was so amazing about this man was even though he was blind, he could see more than anyone else in the crowd because he knew who was passing by. He was ready for change, not just his situation, not just his circumstance, but he was ready to be changed. Verse 42, it says, then he said, Lord, that I may receive sight. Then Jesus said to him, receive your sight, your faith. Say your faith. Your faith has made you well. And immediately he received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw him, gave praise to God. It says, your faith. He said, your faith has made you well. See, our desire should be as the church, as the body of Christ, as Victory Outreach, should be to be faithful, not faithless. See, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, is a very familiar passage. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. See, even though we don't see it, we know that God is working. When you have that type of faith where you're full of faith, now you have a faith that can be seen. I believe that we should all have a type of faith that can be seen, that it's evident, that when people see us, they could recognize and they could see something different about this person. Even when all hell is breaking loose, even though they have many reasons to murmur and complain, they're still optimistic. They still have a smile. They still come to church. They're still faithful. They're still committed. They don't allow the circumstances that they're going through dictate the way they look at God, but that they're full of faith. And it's a faith that could be seen. It's a visible faith. I believe that if we're going to see these great things take place in this end time revival that we are going to experience, we need to be a house full of faith. It can't just be a small group of people. It has to be us collectively together believing, and not just believing, but expecting and knowing that Jesus is able to do it. See, this man had so much faith. Immediately, when he knew he was passing by, he said, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." He was making a declaration that he wanted something to happen. He had that type of faith, and I hope and pray that we have that type of faith. That type of faith where we're saying, "Jesus, even though I don't understand what's taking place, even though it's difficult right now, even though all hell is breaking loose, even though I'm praying for my children, it seems like they're getting worse, even though I'm trying to get my finances in order, but things are not working out for me, and I'm losing my job, and now my car is breaking up, all these different things. I still hope that we can count on all joy, knowing that Jesus is still in control." See, sometimes we don't realize and understand why we go through what we go through. But when it's all said and done and we come out stronger on the other side, we realize that situation and that circumstance was not to destroy us, but to build us up. There's some people here, you need to stay on the wheel and know that Jesus is still working in your life, working in you, working through you, so that he can prepare you for the great things that he wants to do. But we got to be full of faith. Don't grow weary, Victory Outreach. Don't get tired, but be full of faith, knowing that we are going to be that mega church, that we are going to build that balcony, that we are going to build another building, that we are going to double services, that we are going to break barriers, that we are going to reach the city, that we are going to send arrows, that we are going to raise up more people to go and answer the call. But we need some people here tonight that will be full of faith and saying, "God, I put my complete trust in you." Is anyone here tonight getting something? Say, faithful. We got to be faithful, full of faith, visible faith, where the world can see and know that we truly believe what we believe because we know it's the truth. Saying, "God, at your word, I know miracles can happen." There's some people here tonight that you need to get your hearing back. You need to get your sight back. You need to start seeing things the right way. You need to allow God to change your perspective because Jesus is passing by. He's in the house. Verse 43, "And immediately he received his sight and followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw him, gave praise to God." He received his sight. What I love about this man, his situation changed. He was ready to change. He saw. He had vision. What did he do? He began to praise God and followed the master. There's some people here that you need a miracle. You need a miracle, something that God, that man cannot do. You need a miracle. But you already thank God in advance, already visualize how your situation is going to change and how it's going to change you. You need already see how you're going to worship God, how you're going to praise him, how you're going to follow him like never before, how you're going to use that situation to be a testimony of the miracle-working power of God. See, it's like I said, it's not the need. It's the faith. See, I know that Jesus knew what his response was going to be. See, we got to question ourselves, what's going to be our response when things change for us? See, sometimes that's why things don't happen. Because possibly God knows that we're going to go back to living the life we were living before. It's when we come to that place of fully surrendering and saying, "God, not my will, but thy will be done. Whatever you want me to do. Whatever you want me to do, I'll clean toilets, I'll cut the grass, whatever's needed. God, I'll do whatever. I'd rather be a servant in your house than anything. I don't care how I look. I don't care how people perceive me. But God, I just change me. Change me so that my circumstance can change. Let's all stand." Jesus here. He's passing by right now. I feel it so strongly. And see, when the multitude saw this miracle, the same crowd that tried to silence him was that same crowd that was now giving praise to God. You may be doing some things that people around you don't recognize. They may even criticize you. Unsaved family members, unsaved loved ones, whatever the case may be. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Just put your trust in God, in the Master's hand. And those same ones that are trying to silence you will eventually be those ones serving the same God you serve. Lift up your hands right there where you're at. There's miracles in motion right now. And he's more than able. So lift up your hands and get ready to sing this song as they come. But I don't want you to sing this song the way you've ever sang it before. But I want you to sing it as a declaration of saying, God, I know that you are more than able. I know you. And I'm going to trust you. Come on, lift up your hands. Lift up your hands. Lift up your hands. Come on. You're here tonight and you're saying, I'm ready for change. I'm ready to step into that miracle territory. You need a miracle. Or you don't want to be part of the crowd anymore. You want to get your praise back. You want to get your shout back. You want something different to happen. Don't worry about how you're going to look. Maybe there's been some people, possibly you haven't made an altar call in a long time. Tonight's your night. Tonight's your night. Jesus is passing by. The call of God is going forth as well. As people are there here tonight, you got to respond. So if that's you, as the worship continues to go, if that's you, come to the altar in full surrenderance.
You are more than able. Who am I?
so powerful what's happening here at this altar right now. Some people here, you're getting your sight back. You're going to start seeing things the right way. Some people here, now you're going to have an ear to hear. Now you're going to be attentive to the voice of God. Gain your shout back. Some people here tonight, your faith is getting filled up. You're going to start believing God for big things and mighty things and greater things to take place. Just the name of Jesus. Now, if you're here tonight and you say, I need a miracle. I need a miracle. A true miracle. If you need a miracle, lift up your hands. Like, lift it up like high, like full, like the type, like you lift it up where you're saying, God, I want to get your attention right now. Many hands are going up. Come on, lift up your hands. Close your eyes. Visualize how things are going to change right now. Visualize how you're going to praise and worship God when God's hands moved right now. Name of Jesus, the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus, lift up your hands. And if you're a leader, maybe you can lay hands on the person you see a hand lifted. The name of Jesus, the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus, the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus. Healing's taking place right now. Some people that they've been battering arthritis, they're getting healed right now. There's somebody here that got a bad report from the doctor. You're going to go back to that same doctor and it's going to say, I don't understand what happened. I don't know what took place, but that report we gave you was false. Name of Jesus, the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus. God's also healing broken hearts. Some people here, you've had a broken heart. Trials, circumstances, situations, disappointment has allowed your heart to be full of things that God did not intend to be there. God's cleansing you right now. In the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus. Come on, could you lift up your hands? Could you lift up your hands? In the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus. We continue to lift, lay hands, worship, continue to go. Worship, continue to go. Name of Jesus, you need a miracle. Lift up your hands.
He's gonna move.
Pastor Xavier said that really stood out was sometimes before God changes your situation, he wants to change you. And maybe you're facing difficult circumstance, an impossible situation. Maybe you're in a crisis, battling with sickness, maybe a loved one, financial challenges, whatever the case may be. God's not using that to push you away from him. God's using that circumstance to draw you closer to him. To draw closer to him. Because as you draw closer to him, that's when the change begins to take place. That's when God begins to do the work in your life. So you got to be open. Open to that change. Open to whatever it is that God's asking you to change in. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. We thank you for the word that was spoken that ignited our faith to believe you for the impossible. To put our faith and trust in you, God, to be able to have visible faith. And even at times when we may not understand, we may not comprehend, but God, we know that you are with us. And we trust you, God. And we know, God, that you are working things out for our good because we love you and we're called according to your purpose. We thank you, Jesus. Release your miracles now. Release your miracles, healing, provision, deliverance, peace. In the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen and amen. Come on, clap your hands. Come on, clap your hands. Turn around and give somebody a hug. Tell them that you love them. Say, hey, you got this. God's on your side. Come on, give somebody else a hug and say, hey, God's on your side. If God is for you, who could be against you? Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to let you go tonight with a powerful message. Thank you, Pastor Xavier. And we want to remind you, don't forget this Sunday. Be on back here. This Sunday is going to be a powerful time. And also, don't forget to register for the end time revival. This place is going to get sold out. We only have limited seating, so you want to make sure. It's only $10. That's all it is per person. And so you want to make sure that you register. We want to make sure as the mother church, we represent strong. Can I hear a loud amen? So the end time rally, go to victoryoutreach.org, and you want to make sure that you register because that's going to be a powerful time. Our founders are going to be here, Pastor Sonny and Sister Julie. It's going to be a great, great time. Multi-regional service, so you want to make sure that you don't miss out. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to let you go right now. Worship, you can go ahead and take us out with the great victorious song. We love you, and God bless you. We'll see you this Sunday.